this beautiful state to be truly an oasis of peace and calm in an otherwise troubled political sea. I mean in terms of its ethos. Puri, Konark, Jaydev, Ramakant, Rat, Sitakant, Mahapatra, whom I knew personally and really treasured that relationship. The great game changer of history, Kalinga, close by. So let me then say how happy I am to be here for the Kalinga Literary Festival, and this is my first occasion. You all know that literary festivals have sprouted from almost every corner of our great land, and yet there are literary festivals and literary festivals. The challenge now for an author is not to how many literary festivals he goes to, but how many he can say no to, because of the number of requests that come to you. But I can only say to you, and I say it with complete sincerity, that it's a great pleasure to come to the Kalinga Literary Festival. Thank you so much for having me. The subject for the festival this year is about a just society. Equality, equity, the elements that go into a humane approach to things, to humanity at large, and the correlation of all of this with literature, with creativity, with expression. And I think it's a very relevant subject. It's relevant especially in our country because there are several Indias that coexist at the same time. There is an India of great wealth, and if it has been made legitimately, we are proud of it. There is an India of burgeoning middle class, metropolitan cities and small towns, where aspiration is as palpable as something that you can touch, which live on hope, which live on confidence, which live for tomorrow because they believe tomorrow will be in the mold that they think it will be. And there is another India. And that is why the notion of justice, equality and equity remains relevant in our country, perhaps more than any major country in the world. And that India is one of grinding poverty and deprivation. Now, when I say this, this sounds like cliches. But some of us should pause to think. Amidst our many preoccupations, that India today has still the largest number of the abjectly poor in the world. India today has still the largest number of people who can't read or write. And India today has still the largest number of malnutrition children, more than that in percentage terms, of sub-Saharan Africa. Now there are two Indias. One is an India which seems to be producing the largest number of billionaires, many of whom recently have left the country. And there is another India which has still the largest number of the abjectly poor. In addition to this, and this is something perhaps we experience, if not so much now in the urbanized India, but certainly it's an aspect of life. Along with this manifest discrepancy on wealth and well-being, I add well-being because it's not about wealth only. Poverty is about your being deprived of well-being. Well-being in terms of the certainty of tomorrow. Well-being in terms of nutrition. Well-being in terms of health. Well-being in terms of being in a situation where if you fall ill for 2 weeks, you don't have enough to eat. So there are two Indias. There is wealth and well-being, and there is the lack of well-being. And with that, there is, at the level of society, a hierarchical, an incorrigible entrenchment of hierarchy, which should worry us. Not because it is necessarily something that was meant to be so oppressive, but because it has now for millennia become oppressive. And that is the categorization of people in the hierarchy of within society in accordance with caste. In my political life, many people talk to me about the evils of the caste system. And they speak about the need to remove the caste system. And I agree with them, except I want to tell them that if I am a Dalit, I can never forget my caste. Even if I wish to forget it and transcend it and put it behind in the subconsciousness of my mind, the world is there to remind me of where I belong. And that kind of social hierarchy is not only about the proclamation of hierarchy, it is about the using of the social system to perpetuate on a continuing basis an oppressive system of interaction within society. We all know that it exists. We also know that perhaps it should not. But what I find worrying is that many of us take it as something that is a given. And therefore, along with that wealth discrepancy, there is a social system of inequality. So, am I saying today to you that India, in terms of the subject today of a just society where equality and equity matter, do we qualify? Perhaps we qualify in terms of intent. Perhaps we qualify in terms of vision. Perhaps we qualify in terms of what we would like to be. But do we qualify as who we are today? That is the question. We must look at a mirror and see for ourselves whether that aspect is true. And so if both these are true, and believe me, this question of social hierarchies, however much it seems to have become less abrasive within the more cosmopolitan urban settings of India, it is never forgotten. If you don't believe me, go and see the matrimonial ads of any newspaper. They are even divided along caste lines. So you will see that it hasn't gone away. Go to any village, at least I can say to you, in Bihar, in eastern UP, look at the village, and if you were in a drone watching from above, you could see this is the house of those who are at the upper end of the hierarchy, and then gradually there is a descending curve to those who are from the lowest, who are on the lowest rung of the ladder. It's a reality. And while laws can be created to ban discrimination on the basis of caste, the perpetuation of discrimination is something very difficult to eradicate, to prove, to be acted upon in a court of law. You don't have to do anything. You can walk away if somebody comes into the room. You may not like to eat with somebody. Merely on this prejudice of what family you are born into, there are 100 million ways in which you make it clear to that person that somewhere the goal of equality is elusive. That it may exist in our constitution, that it may exist in laws to implement the ideals of the constitution, but it does not exist in real life, not at least to the extent that we would like to. And no amount of laws can change situations where people's mindsets don't begin to change. In spite of that mindset, and that instrument, to my mind, is democracy. Again, this may sound to you as a cliche, but ultimately, when people realize that the establishment will not yield to them what is their due under the law and under the constitution in manners that it should, they will snatch what is their due by the strategic use of the ballot box. And now, in India, the level of empowerment towards equality of those who were hitherto oppressed and at the lower rungs of the social ladder is one of the great and remarkable stories of India. To have somebody from the scheduled caste become the chief minister of UP, to have a situation in Bihar where, unlike in the past, it has become exceptionally difficult for someone from the upper caste to be the chief minister of the state merely because of the demographic reality that they represent an exceptionally minuscule portion of the population. I am not speaking about reverse discrimination. But the fact of the matter is that democracy has empowered people on the basis of their numerical strength, even as they establish a quiescent community from above. The power of an idea goes beyond the intentions of those who craft those ideas. And so, while drafting an egalitarian constitution, many of those who belong to the higher hierarchies would have thought this is good in terms of its writing, but hopefully it will not be translated into practice. But those who were to be its beneficiaries, they were not willing to allow themselves to remain puppets of those who had been ruling them. They were not willing to remain puppets in perpetuity, and therefore there was an aggressive organizational power given to the sense of grievance of being denied their rights, and that has translated into a sea change today in the equations of politics. So therefore, this will change. How fast? How ethically? How much in real terms of equity, because after all, the empowerment of one class, however delayed, does not mean necessarily irrational discrimination of others. These are questions which we as a society have to solve if we truly want a level playing field where there is both equality and equity. And the fourth dimension to this is, why is it that a situation where deprivation and poverty are so manifest, where even in a city like Delhi, next to five-star hotels, you have large slums, people sleeping on pavements, Why is it that this does not scratch and pierce and penetrate through our conscience? We are having a literary festival. There are poets here, there are writers here of great sensitivity who see and observe all of this. But why is it that it does not create in them a genuine sense of anguish so deep that it reflects itself more universally, more substantially in their writings and expression? Again, that's a question to be asked of the community of writers. And to my mind, the answer to that is that very often now most of us take that poverty for granted, which means, in other words, that we do not even notice it. If we see someone, obviously emaciated or hungry or sleeping on the pavement or begging, and that could be an organized racket, but begging or in pain, we pass them by. Because they have become so much the background of our psyche, and so much of it is now rooted in an irrational acceptance that what is wrong is actually the normal. This is what worries. In fact, many foreigners have told me in the course of my career as a diplomat, and some of the best and brightest diplomats have been posted in India. Many foreigners have told me, with a lot of praise for Indians and exceptionally intelligent people, very good conversationalists, some of the best and brightest in certain sectors. And at the end of it, not once, it has happened to me so many times that I have actually recorded it in when I was writing my book, The Great Indian Middle Class. At the end they would say, but Mr. Verma, there's one thing about Indians. They don't notice in their own environs things that shock us, things that appear startling to us, things that we believe these people speaking to us as if they were one of our own, comfortable in English, well-educated, cosmopolitan, abreast of everything that is happening in the world, citizens like me and you. Why don't these people notice that someone who has died lay on Bahadur Shah Zafar Marg for 12 days with the body stinking, but nobody stopped to ask who has died? ये हुआ क्या है कि पढ़े लिखे लोग, प्रतिभाशाली लोग, संवेदनशील लोग, they see everything else except that which is obvious. What is the reason for it? Is it the cumulative legacy we have inherited by which we have begun, even against our will, to accept that which is inequitable? Have we become so coarsened, deadened, that we do not immediately either move our society among other citizens to do something about it? Or do we wait to see that karma will perhaps change things on its own for these people, and even if they are suffering, it's because of a past karma? Or else, it's better to escape into our own little insulated worlds rather than engage with this reality which is frightening, from which I wish to escape, of which I don't wish to be a part of which I want to, for once and for all, forget. Is that the feeling? But the truth is, you can't forget it. It's there. It's right at your doorstep. People quote to me, that India is the fastest growing economy. And I'm proud of that. And very often on television, I even congratulate the government for this achievement. But I ask you, and this is beyond politics, I ask you that if we are the fastest growing economy, notching 7.6% GDP growth, why is it that only last week two women have died in Jharkhand out of starvation? Why is it that our GDP grows but we go down in the global hunger index? Any intelligent person can make a correlation of these two. If there is a high tide which is taking all the boats up, why is it that some boats are perennially, congenitally bogged in the sand, caught in a vicious cycle of poverty? Why? Why do not the economic dividends, the dividends of economic growth beyond percolation, be actually conduited, harnessed, institutionalized to reach those who need it the most? Farmers commit suicide. And chief ministers speak about the fact that we have had the biggest harvest this year. Surely there is a correlation. People speak, 60% of our workforce, I'm mixing a bit of economics towards the question of sensitivities, especially among the writers. People say, and this government has also said at the center, that they will double farmers' income by 2022. It's a goal we welcome. But, you know, shorn of rhetoric, what does this mean? According to government figures, today the median income of an average farmer after deducting costs is 20,000 rupees annually. So if you were to double it in 5 years, it would become 40,000 rupees annually. And if you were to factor in inflation, you can imagine what it means on a monthly basis, 40,000 divided by 12. So have we made real progress for 60% of the people who are, whether they like it or not, in some manner caught within the framework of the agricultural ecosystem? These are questions that we need to ask ourselves. And as intelligent people, we produce the largest number of doctors, largest number of engineers, many of them exceptionally bright, many of them unemployable. We produce them. And this coexists with the fact that with these largest numbers of bright doctors and engineers and others, we also have the largest number of people who can't read and write. So what I'm trying to say is that if we want a just society, if we want equity, if we want equality, if we want the India that we build tomorrow to be based on the foundations not only of the statement of intent but actual change that changes the lives of people on the ground, then among many people who are working towards this goal, I think writers, poets, thinkers, creative people must also become aware of the sheer magnitude of the problem and ask themselves whether outside the cocoon of their own lives, they should start in some manner engaging with this other world. My worry is that that engagement is receding. In fact, there is a contrary trend that is growing. Today we have a new form of escapism. If you see a film called Do Biga Zameen, it was about the travels of a farmer depicted with realism. The iconic role that Balraj Sahni played. Today we have, even for middle class homes, the most opulent sets on Bollywood and our films. Complete, more or less, romanticized, overblown pictures of prosperity. We somehow wish to keep that aspect of India which is depressing, which is uncomfortable, out of our consciousness. The idea is not to acknowledge it, at least. The idea is actually not to acknowledge it. Even that attempt has failed. That attempt is now to provide to people who could otherwise be sensitized a form in which they are able to escape that reality rather than to deal with it. In fact, this is a conscious trend that has developed over the last two decades. And that should worry us again. Perhaps ordinary people do want to escape what is uncomfortable. But writers and all people in the field of creativity have to perhaps make that special effort to counter that entire institutional process that legitimizes escape and come back to that reality which stares us. Because when they write, and if they write, and how they write, in its own small way, can make a difference. So therefore, I think today, to conclude, I would say, we need a pan-Indian literature. Not that we stop writing about other things. I've just done a book on philosophy, on Adi Shankaracharya. But on the whole, can we all contribute here, this great city, to begin to think about the possibility of a pan-Indian literature, identifiable, discernible, verifiable, which is not as elusive as sometimes our intents are? Can we think of a pan-Indian literature which is about anguish, which is about concern, and which is, when necessary, about protest? Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir.